Hello friends, I am Dr. Kajal Mundada. Today we are going to discuss a poem written by a very celebrated and very famous poet in Indian writing, Dilip Chitre. His poem entitled Father Returning Home. Dilip Chitre is one of the most celebrated poets in Indian writing in English, and he was a bilingual poet. And not only this, but Dilip Chitre was also the recipient of Sahitya Academy Award. The poem that we are going to discuss today is entitled Father Returning Home. So obviously, the title indicates us that the poem is about father who is returning home. From where? Of course, we will see that when we will study the poem in detail. But I want to discuss one point with you. Motherhood and mothers are always celebrated and they are much talked of. But how many times do we talk or do we celebrate our fathers? Since our childhood, we have grown up listening to the stories from our mythologies. We have the figures like Lord Ram from Ramayana and Bhishma from Mahabharata. These two are the celebrated sons in our culture because we find that these two have given or they have done great sacrifice and they are the figures ideal in front of us. Lord Rama, to fulfill the promise of his father, accepted seclusion or vanvas for 14 years. And on the other hand, we have the character of Bhishma from Mahabharata, who declared that he will not marry because he wanted his father's happiness, who was in love with a fisher king daughter and wanted to marry her. So to fulfill the desire of father, he declared that he will not have his own family. So these two examples from our mythologies, they are considered as the great examples of the ideal sons. We had been listening to these stories and they form the role models in front of us. But in reality, when we look around in our society, we find that many times father is not such a celebrated figure. In fact, we find an old father as an alienated figure in the society, in the family. And this creates a very pathetic picture of an old father. What Dilip Chitre has done is that he has portrayed a wonderful picture of an alienated old father. Now let's try to understand this poem. Father Returning Home is the title. My father travels on late evening train, standing among silent commuters in the yellow light. So he talks about his own father. He says, my father travels on late evening train. How is he traveling? He is standing. He's standing because he doesn't get a place to sit down in a crowded train. So standing among silent commuters. Commuters are the people who travel from one place to another place on daily basis for work purpose. So my father is traveling among silent commuters. Means the travelers, they are daily travelers and they are silent. Nobody is speaking. Nobody is having conversation with the fellow travelers. And in the yellow light. Yellow light is indicative of the evening time. It is the time of evening and my father is traveling by train amongst the silent commuters. Suburbs slide past his unseeing eyes. Suburban areas. So suburban areas, they pass his unseeing eyes. Means he is not noticing what is there outside the window. So it actually talks about the situation that the journey has become so monotonous that it is not at all enchanting or interesting, and that's why the travelers are not interested in watching outside the window. The suburban areas, they simply pass unseeingly or unnoticed. His shirt and pants are soggy, and his black raincoat stained with mud, and his bag stuffed with books is falling apart. These three lines talk about the uncomfortable journey that the father has undertaken. Now, what is the situation of the father? His shirt and pants are soggy. Soggy means soaked with moisture or water. So his shirt and pants, they are soaked with moisture, they are soggy, and his black raincoat is stained with mud. Means it is not clean, it is unclean because it is stained with mud. And his bag stuffed with books is falling apart. He is carrying a bag. And in that bag, he has stuffed the books, and he is not able to manage the bag, and that's why the bag or the books in the bag are falling apart. In a way, his dress and his bag, they indicate that the journey is not that comfortable. In fact, it is a very uncomfortable journey for the father. His eyes, dimmed by age, fade homeward. His eyes are dimmed. The vision of his eyes has now become blur, or he is not able to see the things very clearly because of the old age. But still, his eyes are moving, or they are searching for the home. Homeward they are looking. Fade homeward through the humid monsoon night. Father is so eager to see his family that to see his family members, that he is not even bothering about the hazards of the travel. He simply wants to reach home. And that's why the poet says his eyes, dimmed by age, fade homeward through the humid monsoon night. It is the humid monsoon night. Now look here, the poet has made use of humid with night. Now nights are not humid. In fact, it is the weather or the atmosphere that is usually humid. So we find that the adjective humid is transferred from its proper place to night. That is another word. So this is an instance of transferred epithet, a poetic device in which an epithet, that is an adjective, is transferred from its original place or with the original word to something else closely associated with it. Now I can see him getting off the train like a word dropped from a long sentence. So the father now is getting off the train. As he has reached the station, he is trying to come out of the train. But his coming out of the train is compared to a word that is dropped from a long sentence. So in a way, the poet establishes here the direct comparison between father's getting off the train and a word dropped from the sentence. So this is an instance of simile. So we find here the comparison is made between father and a word. Father is just like a small word dropping from a sentence. It shows that father has least importance in the society and least importance in his family also, because his presence or absence doesn't make any difference to the people in the society nor to the family members. And that's why he is not much cared character. He, like a word dropped from a long sentence, he hurries across the length of the grey platform, crosses the railway line, enters the lane. So the father in a hurried way, tries to cross the length of the grey platform. Here the platform is also referred to as grey. It shows the old age of the father. It's something like the resemblance has been established between the old station and the father. And it shows the dullness in father's life, and it shows the dullness on the platform also. So he crosses the railway line and he enters the lane. His chappals are sticky with mud, but he hurries onward. His chappals are sticky with mud. But even in that situation, he hurriedly tries to move on and reach the home. Now the chappals, when they are mud stricken, or whenever there is mud stuck to the chappals, it becomes very difficult for a person to walk in a hurried way. But the father in that situation also is trying to move fast towards the home. This actually shows that he is trying to cross the railway line and how anxious he is to reach the home. He is not aware of the difficulties. He is not bothering about the difficulties. He had some problems, but ignoring them, his earnest desire is to reach the home to his family. Home again, I see him drinking weak tea, eating a stale chapati, reading a book. But when he returns home, what is the situation? Poet says, I see him drinking weak tea. Now tea, hot beverages, they are actually, they usually are taken for refreshment. We feel refreshed to have tea. But his tea is weak. The chapati that he eats is stale chapati. Tea and weak tea and stale chapati actually indicate the non-nourishing food, or the non-nourishing food. In fact, he is deprived of the good food. As an old man, he needs good, healthy, nourishing food. But he is not given that. He is not provided good, healthy food. What he is given? He is given weak tea and stale chapati, and he is reading a book. So stale chapati here represents non-nourishing food, or the food that is not very good. So here we find that the poet is making use of a part to represent the whole, and this is the poetic device known as synecdoche. In synecdoche, a part represents the whole and the whole represents a part. Just for example, we usually say India won the match. It is not actually that the entire country India has won the match, but the Indian team has won the match. So a part is represented by the whole. In the same way, food is represented here by stale chapati, the unnourishing food. He goes into the toilet to contemplate man's estrangement from a man-made world. Father goes to toilet to contemplate means to think deeply. What does he think? He thinks of man's estrangement from the man-made world. How the man is made a stranger in this man-made world. Estrangement is actually alienation, separation, seclusion. Man, father, he has been secluded. He has been alienated from the world that he himself had created, the man-made world. Coming out, he trembles at the sink, the cold water running over his brown hands. A few droplets cling to the graying hair on his wrists. So he comes out of the toilet and he trembles at the sink. He is not able to move in a stable manner, and he is not able to move in a strong manner. That's why he trembles at the sink. When he tries to wash his brown hands, we find that few droplets of cold water, they remain stuck on his wrists, or on the gray hair of his wrist. His sullen children have often refused to share jokes and secrets with him. His sullen children, sullen, bad-tempered, uncaring children. They have refused to share, means they don't want to share the jokes or secrets with their father. They have alienated him. They have totally separated him. They are not including the old father into their world of happiness, of joy and secrets. He will now go to sleep, listening to the static on the radio, dreaming of his ancestors and grandchildren. So, since nobody wants to talk to him, nobody wants to entertain him, father goes into the room to sleep. But while sleeping also, he is not given the proper amusement or entertainment. In fact, he was destined to listen only to the cracking sounds on radio. And that's why listening to the static on the radio means the father actually is not able to get the entertainment also in a proper manner. His least expectations of listening to the radio is also not fulfilled. Dreaming of his ancestors and grandchildren. Whom do he see in his dreams? He dreams of his ancestors. Ancestors represent his past and grandchildren represent his future. So the old father is thinking of his past and of his future, that is, of his ancestors and his grandchildren. Thinking of nomads. Nomad is actually a wandering tribal, the person who doesn't have a fixed home, and as a result, he keeps on wandering from one place to another place. And father is just like a nomad of nomads entering a subcontinent through a narrow pass. Through a narrow pass, as a nomad tries to enter a new subcontinent, in the same way, father is also a nomad. He is just like a tribal wanderer. He is a modern nomad who is entering a new subcontinent, probably in his dreams. So we find that as a nomad doesn't have his own home, and as a result, he keeps on wandering from one place to another place. But here we find a father, though he has a home, though he has a family, still he is referred to as a nomad, because home is where love is, respect is, and where your heart is. But when you are neglected by your own children, by your own family members, the situation is like you are not wanted, you are disliked by them, you become a burden for them. In this situation, a father, though he is in a home, feels that he is a nomad. And on this line, the poem ends. In this way, we find that a very pathetic picture of an old father is drawn by Dilip Chitre here. And this is all about father returning home. I hope you followed me. Thank you.